The Hungarian After Revolution was a part of the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire near the end of the First World War. We saw the First Hungarian Republic. It existed short. It was followed by the Hungarian Soviet Republic, which also was a short-lived state. And then the Hungarian Republic emerged, which also existed briefly. But why? Well, then more you learn in this short-lived states episode about the Hungarian Republic. Keep watching. As the Austro-Hungarian Empire crumbled near the end of the First World War, the Aster Revolution occurred in Hungary. On the 23rd of October, the Hungarian Social Democrats and the Radicals founded a national committee led by the liberal Count Mihály Károly. This committee insisted it was the only legitimate representative of the Hungarian people. An independent Hungary was well on its way now, especially since the National Committee could count on the support of large numbers of nationalist officers and soldiers. On October 30th, they renounced their loyalty to the Habsburg Emperor. Next morning, Károly was appointed as Minister President. The National Committee became the new government, as the red, white, and green tricolor replaced the dual monarchy flags on public buildings. Many people celebrated in the streets. Elsewhere in the crumbling empire, national revolutions occurred, and these happened fairly peaceful as well. Yes, there was some violence, but it was not widespread. Violence would erupt later. To explain this, I refer to this ethnographic map you see here. You see that there are concentrations of groups of people. However, these are not well defined. Look at Transylvania, for example. Here you see a large concentration of Romanians, but further east, Hungarians dominated the lands. And that gave rise to problems when nations started claiming these territories. Who defines the borders and how? Hungary was basically powerless because of the self-disarmament of the Hungarian army urged by US President Woodrow Wilson, which Károly yielded to. And since Hungary was seen as a defeated nation by the Entente, they were in no hurry to call the invading Czechoslovaks, Serbs, and Romanians to stop. On November 12th, the Romanian army marched into Transylvania and advanced further into Hungary. In March 1919, the Hungarian communists, led by Béla Kun, seized power in Budapest and proclaimed the Hungarian Soviet Republic. Eventually, that state was toppled by the Romanians as they conquered Budapest. But the Romanians didn't do it alone. No, they were aided by nationalist Hungarians who wanted to take down the communist state, among which Admiral Miklós Horthy, as the head of the National Army. Eventually, the First Hungarian Republic, also known as Hungarian People's Republic or Hungarian Democratic Republic, was restored, but soon taken down. And here's how. The restored First Hungarian Republic was now headed by Gyula Pidl, who worked feverish to abolish the laws implemented by the previous Soviet government. Private property was restored and the revolutionary tribunals were eliminated. On August 6th, his government was overthrown in an armed coup. István Friedrich now took over. This coup was also backed by the Romanians. However, the commander of the National Army, Miklós Horthy, refused to carry out its instructions since the state wasn't recognized by the Entente powers anyway. Horthy's troops advanced into the areas that were not under Romanian control. The state was led by authoritarian Hungarian army officers, and they carried out the White Terror. The White Terror was an answer to Kun's Red Terror, in which countless of alleged sympathizers of the previous regimes were targeted. Think of left-wing sympathizers, but also many Jews. Some were savagely killed, and as a result of the White Terror, countless of people fled the country.
This White Terror, which raged throughout the countryside until the autumn of 1919 and died away only slowly in the spring of 1920, bore no resemblance of legality. It claimed around 5,000 lives and put 70,000 citizens behind bars or crowded them into hastily erected internment camps and forced many suspects to flee abroad. The country had descended in chaos and Romanians were still occupying the capital city. Allied diplomats urged democratic reforms. For the Hungarians, this was the only way to get the Romanians out of the country. Horthy entered the capital in November 1919 and had an army of 25,000 men. A new government was formed that month. but political factions displayed a lack of unity and political and economic instability remained. All political parties did agree on severing the connection with the Habsburg crown, but whether or not the monarchy should continue and whether or not King Charles was still the rightful ruler of Hungary, that was a topic of fierce debate. Since the Allies wouldn't accept King Charles on the throne, Miklós Horthy was appointed as regent on the 1st of March 1920. Horthy was able to bring opposing factions together, thanks to his sincere manner in dealing with others, his ability in several languages, and the troops under his command. He was able to win the support of the Entente representatives stationed in Budapest. His active tolerance of the White Terror has made him acceptable to the enemies of reform as well as those opposed to revolution. With Horthy as regent, Hungary thus became a constitutional monarchy. Later that year, the infamous Treaty of Trianon was signed. More on that in another video. And so, also the Hungarian Republic bit the dust. Now, if you'd like to know why the Hungarians eventually sided with the Axis, you can click right here. Thank you so much for watching. Do not forget to subscribe. Consider becoming a patron, because with your donations, I can make better, cooler, and more awesome content for you. Best wishes from Budapest, Hungary.